concerned in as far as animal responses are concerned. We will now go to responses in plants. Responses in plants are referred to as tropisms or tropic responses. Responses in plants are actually brought about by growth movements. Plants respond by growing. Plants don't locomote. Plants don't change in position. So only parts of the plants are able to grow. And as they grow, that brings about what? Response. So what is tropism? Or what is tropic response? Is actually a growth movement that actually makes an organism or a plant respond to changes in the environment. And that means responses in plants are brought about by growth curvatures. They are brought about by growth curvatures. So, when a plant has a part that has grown, it means it has actually brought about response. When a plant of actually any species has actually had its part growing, that means that is actually responsive plant. So a tropism is a growth movement due to a change in condition within an environment where the plant is found. So responses in plants are brought about growth curvatures. You should notice this, that the stimulus that brings about change in that plant or in that part of the plant is actually unidirectional, meaning the stimulus is coming from a specific direction. Then the response that is actually exhibited in that plant is actually directional, or actually towards a particular direction. We shall actually be able to look at different types of responses in plants. The first one is what we call phototropism. This is where a plant responds, isn't it, by having a growth curvature, isn't it, due to the changes in the intensity of light and also the direction of light. So a growth curvature brought about by direction and intensity of light. A growth curvature brought about by the change in the direction of light and also intensity of light. For example, roots are negatively phototropic, while shoots are positively phototropic. Shoots grow towards light, while roots grow away or grow in the opposite direction to the direction of light. So shoots are positively phototropic, they grow towards light. Roots are negatively phototropic, they grow away from light. Number two, we have what we call geotropism. Geotropism is a growth curvature brought about due to changes in the direction of force of gravity. So we will say that the force of gravity is that force that actually pulls objects towards the center of the earth. And that means that the shoots are negatively geotropic and the roots are positively geotropic. The shoots grow in the opposite direction to the force of gravity. Okay? The roots grow in the same direction to the force of gravity. So, roots are positively geotropic, shoots are negatively geotropic. Because the force of gravity acts downwards by pulling objects toward the center of the earth. Number three is what we have as chemotropism. A growth curvature in plants brought about by changes in the concentration of chemicals. For example, when the anthers and the filament produce the pollen grains, because we refer to them as the main parts of a flower, the pollen grains are actually able to land on the stigma through what you call the animal means or the wind means or any other means. When the pollen grains land on the stigma, they grow in what you call a pollen tube. The pollen tube gets attracted to the embryo sac where the ova or the ova are produced. Saginate. On reaching in the embryo sac, there is actually fertilization where the planet grains having the main nucleus will be able to produce that male nucleus and allow for the male nucleus to fuse with the female nucleus produced by the ovum, so that fertilization takes place within the embryo sac. That means that the embryo sac has the eggs, which normally produce chemicals that actually direct the pollen tube to grow towards the embryo sac, so that fertilization can take place. Another one is what you call hydrotropism. This is a growth curvature in relation to the changes in concentration of moisture or water. Shoots are negatively hydrotropic, while roots are positively hydrotropic. Shoots grow away from moisture in the ground or water in the ground, then roots grow towards the moisture or water in the ground, so that they can be able to help the plant to have water, because the roots are the ones that absorb water or moisture for the plant, so that the plant does not wilt and it actually maximally manufactures food for its growth and development. The last one is thigmotropism, or what you refer to as haptotropism. This is a growth curvature brought about when a part of the plant comes in contact with a hard object. For example, the climbing stems of some plants which are non-woody, or the dendrites of some plants will always coil around objects as they grow. So, thigmotropism or haptotropism is a growth curvature brought about when a part of a plant comes in contact with an object within an environment. For example, when the climbing stems climb or actually twine around branches or other stems of woody plants, or the tendrils twine around the tendrils twine around the branches or the stems or parts of a plant or even other objects. That is what we refer to as thigmotropism or haptotropism. Now, I want to give the importance of responses in animals. Responses in animals are very important to facilitate, one, the organism to be able to migrate to safer habitats where they can be able to obtain nutrients and mates. That's the first importance of responses in animals, to enable organisms to migrate to safer habitats where they can obtain nutrients and mates. Number two, chemotaxis allows room for fertilization to take place so that young ones of those organisms can be produced after the gestation period. Responses in animals will enable organisms to actually be able to actually avoid very harmful stimuli, like a higher light intensity, very high temperatures, or even predators. So, to actually be able to actually run away from very harmful stimuli, like high light intensity, high temperatures, or predators, which can harm the organisms. So, one, chemotaxis allows room for fertilization. Number two, we are saying organisms can be able to migrate to safer habitats where they can obtain nutrients and mates. Number three, this allows the organism or organisms to be able to actually run away from harmful stimuli, like high light intensity, very high temperatures, or even predators. The importance of tropic responses or responses in plants are like, when you look at phototropism, it's actually a growth curvature that helps the plant to expose its leaves and flowers for maximum photosynthesis and maximum production in the plant. When you look at geotropism, it allows the root to go deep into the soil, so that as the root penetrates through the soil particles, it actually ends up getting to areas where it can be able to absorb enough water for the plant. When you look at haplotropism, it facilitates support in plants which are actually having stems which are non-woody. When you look at chemotropism, this allows fertilization to take place in plants. When you look at hydrotropism, this enables the roots, as they penetrate through the soil, they are able to absorb water for the plant, or they have the ability to enable the plant to have an access to water. That is very, very important. So we have said, phototropism exposes the leaves of the plant so that the plant can have its leaves absorbing maximum light for photosynthesis. I've said geotropism enables the roots to be able to penetrate through the soil and be able to have an access to adequate water and mineral salts for maximum plant growth. We are saying chemotropism will enable fertilization to take place in plants. We are saying hydrotropism will enable the plant to have its roots accessing enough water or moisture. And lastly, thigmotropism or haplotropism enables the plants, especially the non-woody plants, to receive support from the woody plants or other objects within the environment. And that is also able to expose the leaves of those non-woody plants so that they can receive maximum light for maximum photosynthesis. We want to go to other responses called nicty nasty. And before we look at nicty nasty, we should actually be able to have what we call nasty responses. Nasty responses is actually a response that is very unique in plants. For example, you can say a nasty response is an non-directional stimuli. An non-directional response, an non-directional movement in plants due to diffuse stimuli. So, a nasty response is a non-directional movement in plants due to diffuse stimuli. A non-directional response or a non-directional movement in plants due to diffuse stimuli. Examples of nasty responses in plants are like the opening and closing of flowers. The opening and closing of leaves. The opening and closing of leaves of Mimosa budica when touched. The opening and closing of leaves of Mimosa budica when touched. So those are just examples of nasty responses in plants. So nasty responses is brought about when there's what you call change in target pressure. For example, when the bases of the petals or the bases of the leaves of some plants are touched, this makes the bases of the petals and the leaves to lose water rapidly, hence this reduces tugger pressure. When tugger pressure is reduced, what happens? There is rapid closure of the leaves or rapid closure of the flowers. We are mostly interested in pressure-sensitive swellings at the bases of the petals and leaves of these plants. The pressure-sensitive swellings called pulvini at the bases. So I'm saying the pressure-sensitive swellings at the bases of the petals or leaves of some plants, which are referred to as pulvini, will be able to actually bring about the changes in tugger pressure, hence making the flowers or the leaves to close abruptly. Examples of these nasty responses that are brought about by the pressure-sensitive swellings called pulvini, when they either lose or gain their target pressure, are like nicty nasty. So the first nasty response is what you call nicty nasty. A student was asking, what is the other name for nicty nasty? Or what is the other name for nasty response? The other name for nasty response is nastism. Nastism. So nasty responses, which are non-directional movements due to diffuse stimuli, are also called nastism or nasty responses. So if someone asks you, what is a nasty response? Or what are nastism responses? Nasty responses or nastism responses are non-directional responses, especially in plants due to diffuse stimuli. We have said these responses are brought about by pressure-sensitive swellings at the bases of the petals and the leaves of some plants, such that through the loss or gain tugger pressure, the leaves or flowers will end up closing or opening. So I've said the first type of nasty response is called nicty nasty, which is also called slip movement. Nicty nasty or slip movement. Nicty nasty, the spelling NYCTINNSTY. Nicty nasty or slip movement. There are two types of nicty nasty or slip movements. Number one is what we refer to as photonasty. Photonasty is actually a non-directional movement or response of parts of a plant when they respond to changes in light intensity. For example, you'll find some flowers opening and closing due to changes in light intensity. The second one is photonasty. This is an undirectional movement, as I've said, due to changes in light intensity. And now, the other one is what you refer to as thermonasty, which is actually an undirectional movement due to changes in temperatures. For example, some leaves will end up abruptly closing or opening due to changes in temperature. And even some flowers will end up closing or opening in a hot weather. That is thermonasty and photonasty lying under what we refer to as what? Nicty nasty or slip movements. The next one is referred to as haptonasty, a non-directional movement due to contact with a solid object. For example, the leaves of Mimosa pudica will abruptly close when they are touched, or when the stems of those leaves are touched, or when the bases of those leaves are touched, or when those leaves themselves are touched, especially for Mimosa pudica, will actually end up making those leaves to abruptly close. And remember, even the closure of leaves of Mimosa pudica can be brought about by the changes in temperature. So when the leaves of Mimosa pudica, or the bases of those leaves, or even the stems of those plants of Mimosa pudica are touched, the leaves abruptly close. And even when the temperatures increase or decrease, it can bring a change in the leaves of that plant. Where, when the temperature increases, the leaves of Mimosa pudica will end up closing abruptly. Now, something else I want to introduce to students is, for example, you'll find cases whereby chemonasty is actually prevailing. What is chemonasty? Non-directional movement due to changes in the concentration of chemicals. You'll have some plants, like insectivorous plants. These plants grow in areas where there is a deficiency of nitrogenous compounds, like urea and ammonium compounds. So what do these plants do? These plants will actually obtain their nitrogen from insects. For example, the sundew or the drosera plant, which is an insectivorous plant, will actually end up getting the nitrogen in what? In the insects that it will end up trapping. For example, when an insect lands on a drosera, the insect actually ends up touching the hairs, which are very sensitive. This makes the midrib of the drosera to lose water rapidly. And because the insect is inside, it makes the tentacles of the insect actually flip in. And as the insects find their way inside the leaf of that drosera, that stimulates the leaf of that drosera to actually secrete digestive enzymes that will digest that insect to be able to produce nitrogen for the plant. So what happens in chemonasty? In chemonasty, we have what you call non-directional movement of leaves of those plants which grow in nitrogen deficient soils, such that when an insect lands on that leaf of that drosera plant or the sundew, the hairs are touched. And as the hairs are touched, that leaf will end up losing water rapidly, especially its midrib, and that makes the tentacles to actually flip in, and that is how an insect is actually captured. And that makes now the leaf to produce digestive juices that will digest the insect to produce the nitrogen for the plant. Now, apart from chemonasty, haptonasty, and lignonasty or sleep movement, we have also something called, and which is very, very, very important for the student to be able to understand. There are cases whereby an insect can actually land on a leaf of a venus flytrap, which is also actually an insectivorous plant. When that insect lands on that venus flytrap leaf, the midrib of the venus flytrap, in as far as its leaf is concerned, will lose water rapidly. And when the midrib loses water, that reduces the tugger pressure of the leaf. When the tugger pressure is reduced, the trap springs inside, or the trap springs inwards. When the trap springs inwards, the spines interlock. And when the spines interlock, the insect is trapped. And when the insect is trapped, that is how the digestive juices are produced by the venous flytrap leaf, so that when the insect is digested, the nitrogen is well delivered to the plant. So, under nastic movements, we majorly have lignonasty, where we have photonasty and thermonasty, we have chemonasty, we have haptonasty, and lastly, we have what you call hydronasty. For example, when you go to a plant called dandelion, a dandelion plant will have its flowers closing in a very humid environment. That is what you call hydronasty. When the atmosphere is humid, when the air is humid, the flowers of a dandelion species will abruptly close due to that change in humidity, due to that change in the moisture in the atmosphere. So we have four major movements called nastic movements or nastic responses as far as plants are concerned. Lignonasty, having thermonasty and photonasty, chemonasty, haptonasty, and lastly, hydronasty. And remember, when you talk about a venus flytrap trapping an insect, when the spines interlock so that nitrogen is well provided, that is actually an example of what we call haptonasty movement due to contact. Due to contact. So under contact or under haptonasty, we have touching the leaves of Mimosa pudica that now makes those leaves to actually fall. Number two, when an insect lands on a venus flytrap, making the midrib to lose water, hence the trap springs inside, or the trap springs inwards. Hence, when the spines interlock, the insect is trapped to be able to provide nitrogen when it is digested by the digestive juices of that plant. We have mentioned the chemonasty, for example, in sandew or the drosera, which is an insectivorous plant. And lastly, hydronasty, when the flowers of an anelid species will abruptly close in a humid environment. That is it as far as plants are concerned. Importance of nasty or nastic movements or nasticism. Number one, when the flowers close, the delicate parts of the flowers are protected. Number two, this reduces the rate of water loss through transpiration. When the leaves close, number three, this regulates the temperature of the plant. We have three very important uses of nastic movements as far as plants are concerned. One, to regulate the temperature in a plant. Number two, to be able to protect the delicate parts of a flower. Number three, to be able to reduce the rate of transpiration so that when the leaves close, the plant does not lose water excessively. We now want to go back to what you call responsive animals. And under responsive animals, we want to actually look at how an animal's sensitivity is actually carried out or well taken care of. For example, what someone needs to understand is that an animal, which is a complex organism, which is a multicellular organism, has two types of systems that help it to coordinate and to be able to bring about response. Number one, we have what you call the nervous system or the neurosensory system. Number two, we have what we refer to as the endocrine system. So animals have two types of what? Systems that facilitate coordination and response. Number one, the neurosensory system or the nervous system. Number two, the endocrine system or the hormonal system. So we have endocrine system or hormonal system. Number two, the neurosensory or the nervous system. But if you can look at that, I want just to tell you that when you look at organisms under phylum Arthropoda, and such organisms are like insects, and I think what you need to understand is that under phylum Arthropoda, we have these classes. Phylum Arthropoda carries the following classes. We have class Insecta. So phylum Arthropoda has the following classes. We have class Insecta. We have class Arachnida. We have class Chilopoda. We have class Diplopoda. So I'm saying class Insecta, class Arachnida, class Chilopoda, class Diplopoda, and class Ustisha. So phylum Arthropoda has class Insecta, class Arachnida, class Chilopoda, class Diplopoda, and class Crustacea. These organisms have also a well-elaborate system of bringing about coordination and response. When you look at an insect under class Insecta, like a grasshopper, or even a butterfly or a moth, when you look at a tick or a spider or a mite and class Arachnida, or when you look at a centipede and a class Chilopoda, or when you look at a millipede and a class Diplopoda, or when you look at a crab and a class Crustacea, you realize that they have several nerves called peripheral nerves. They are what you call peripheral nerves. These peripheral nerves are able to get connected to what you call a ventral nerve cord, which forms part of their vertebral column, of which they don't have what you call the vertebral column. But now, the peripheral nerves from other parts of the body of that organism can get joined to what you call the ventral nerve cord. The ventral nerve cord will now take these peripheral nerves to the brain. When all these peripheral nerves are concentrated in the head of that organism under phylum Arthropoda, they form what you call cerebral ganglia. So I've said the peripheral nerves are coming from different parts of the body. Those peripheral nerves coming from the different parts of the body get concentrated or connected to the ventral nerve cord, which now acts as like the vertebral column or the spinal cord in human beings. Those nerves are now able to get to the head. When they reach the head, they become concentrated in the head. And as they become concentrated in the head, they form what you call cerebral ganglia. The cerebral ganglia will now act as the brain in insects or arachnids. So we have the peripheral nerves getting connected to the ventral nerve cord, these nerves concentrating